Hello, thank you, everybody. We're in the 7 o'clock stretch now, so if anybody wants to stand up real fast and take 10 seconds just to stretch yourselves out. I know it's been a long day. We're almost done. And while we're doing that, I can do some yoga up on stage, too. My name is Jeff Orlowski. I directed this film, Chasing Ice. And this is a project that never was really intended to be a film. We kind of came into it backwards. It's a project that had very humble beginnings at the start when this photographer, James, had an idea to do time lapses of glaciers. And the concept at face value is fairly simple, and now in 2013, when we think about climate change, pretty much everybody thinks about melting glaciers and changing glaciers. But back in 2007, when this project originated, that notion had never really been explored before in terms of really documenting and seeing how glaciers are changing and how rapidly they're changing. So James had this concept, and fortunately I got to meet him through a friend and got involved early on the project, early on the team, and was able to travel with James to Iceland, to Greenland, and to Alaska. And like I said, we were never really planning on making a film. My main role was to serve as an assistant to James, and then also I was shooting video at the same time for archival purposes, for marketing materials, for YouTube videos, and dramatic stuff kept happening every step of the way. Every trip that we went on, more and more crazy things happened, similar to what you saw with what Florian showed a little while ago. But I'll just take a brief moment right now, and we're going to show a trailer in just a second. And I wanted to give you a little bit more about the backstory after the clip, and then I also want to give you a sense of what we were trying to accomplish from an impact perspective with the material that we collected. So can we roll the trailer?
On the phone with Jim on one of our regular check-ins. Jim, nothing's happening.
It's starting, Adam. I think, Adam, it's starting right here.
Look at that. Look at the whole thing.
It all started in Iceland.
I think I'm so certain to get wet, I'll take my boots off.
I never imagined that you could see glaciers this big disappearing in such a short time. There's a powerful piece of history that's unfolding in these pictures, and I have to go back. The initial goal was to put out 25 cameras for 3 years, shoot every hour as long as it was daylight, that would show you how the landscape was changing.
Oh, this is the way to travel, my friend.
Putting really delicate electronics in the harshest conditions on the planet. It's not the nicest environment for technology.
I do not want to go any lower than this. It's just bottomless.
I'm going out here on this broken fin, and I assume it won't collapse.
Every once in a while, you get to say,
what were you thinking?
Maybe that office job wasn't so bad.
This thing is loose.
Rock!
It's not working. God. All of that obsession means nothing if it doesn't work.
Just be careful. Don't get too close to the edge, all right?
It's terrifying.
His knee has had two surgeries, and it really could use a third.
We go to that point where he can't anymore, and sometimes he's going further.
We have no one raising engine number two.
This is big stuff happening right now.
Okay, onward.
Memory of the landscape. That landscape is gone. It may never be seen again in the history of civilization, and it's stored right here.
You can bring the lights up. Thank you. I just want to give you a little bit of sense of the backstory in terms of how we got to where the film ended up. After spending about a year and a half following James, working with him out in the field, I finally convinced him to let me go ahead and make a feature film about this. And we spent quite a bit of time focusing on how do we craft the story, how do we tell the story. And at first, the main idea that we had was we had this story about this photographer, and we really didn't want to make a film about climate change. We were trying to make a film about James Balog as a photographer. And part of the reason there was that there had been so many other films about climate change that had been made. We didn't think that we could do anything really powerful and seminal in that space. But after we were screening the film for friends and colleagues and other filmmakers and editors, we got a lot of feedback from people. And really, we realized that we needed to shift the focus of the story away from being solely about a photographer and really framing it about the story of climate change and using James as the vehicle to tell that story. But one of the important things that we were really trying to be aware of was that, I mean, most of the people here in this audience, we're aware of what is going on regarding climate change. So many of the people here at this conference understand the reality of the science, understand how the planet is changing. But the audience that we wanted to get to, the audience that we wanted to reach out to, doesn't necessarily understand all of that. And what we were, you might have noticed in the trailer itself, there's no explicit reference to climate change as a phrase. We're not actually trying to market this as a climate change film. We were really trying to frame this as an adventure story and a photography story using James Balog as a vehicle, as a messenger. I think because of that, because of the way we frame the film, it's given us a lot of access to places we never would have gotten access to. So we premiered the film at Sundance. It has gone on to, I don't even know how many film festivals at this point. It's won over 35 awards. As Vance mentioned, it was nominated for the Academy Award as well. And when we were there at the Academy Awards ceremony, the film got a minute of airtime showcasing the imagery and the photography and the time lapses to 350 million people around the world. And that was access that we never would have had we gone in, I believe, had we gone in with the climate change message as opposed to the adventure story. So this is something that we were really trying to focus on in terms of how we were going to reach out with the imagery and framing it around the imagery. At this point, over 10 million people have seen the film. It's been broadcast on National Geographic for worldwide television. And we constantly get feedback from people saying how the film changed their impression of climate change, that a single 75-minute screening of the film has shifted the way people think about the issue. We've done a number of screenings for high school audiences. We did one screening for a Catholic high school in Utah. And at the end of the screening, there are about 300, 350 students. I asked the students if the film changed their opinion about climate change, and more than half of the kids in the audience raised their hand. And you could tell that in that short period of time, it really made people think a different way about what's going on with this issue. And all of that comes back to what James was able to figure out from a visual perspective, how to take this story that we hear debated in the media, we hear people bickering about it, we hear numbers and statistics and charts, but how do we get away from those bullet points, and how do we make it emotional? How do we make it resonant so people feel it in their guts and their hearts? I have a lot of hope about climate change, about what we can do and what we will do as a society moving forward. I have hope because I feel like we have no other alternative. We need to make a change in this regard. And when people discuss how difficult this challenge is going to be, I really look back in American history, and there's another great example, another great precedent for a major obstacle and a major challenge that we've been able to overcome. There was a period where our economic engine in America was based on something that we now look at as being unethical. And there were companies and corporations that used slave labor as a dominant force for how they made their money, how they ran their organization, how they ran their companies. And when we had a debate in America over whether or not we should continue to use slaves, there were people who said, you can't take away our workforce, our economic model, this is going to be terrible for the economy, you can't do this to us. A lot of similar arguments that we hear now about climate change. But ultimately, we made the ethical decision to go down a certain path where we knew we needed to take the moral high road. And I firmly believe that we are facing a similar debate right now, and that we need to, as a society, take the moral high ground, where we know that burning fossil fuels at the current pace is unethical, it's unsustainable, it is terrible for future generations. And we will need to figure out how to make it economically viable and economically positive for us to make that shift. So I just want to thank WILD and thank Vance and the WILD Foundation for their support of Chasing Ice and for the opportunity to speak here. And thank you. I look forward to a really great conference this week.